end it for them, or?
You just have a short look. If you see the map, you can. You feel better?
Since
you're right.
Yeah, I'm good. Thank you.
And where's the one from Finland?
I know, that's... She's not here yet. She's just behind
me. Huh? See, it's still in the way. Yeah? It's still in the way. What? He's thirsty. I thought we lost Finland.
Still here.
So, how is it going with you? You get some calm? Etienne?
Well, I'm trying to concentrate, and I guess it's going better. It seems like it's getting more peaceful, and but I can see where it'll take a long time. But that's where we are, right? We have time.
I mean, we take the example, you know, when you do practice, yeah? No matter if you do meditation, insight meditation, or calm meditation. I mean, take the idea of that child, you know, who just learns to walk. Whenever it can walk, you know, then it's finished. It doesn't think, oh, I still have to wait 1 year. I mean, it wouldn't be able to do it, yeah? If you think about the future, you know how long it will take. You know, I mean, we are not able to do it. Yeah? We become despairing, yeah? We just do it. What else is there to do, yeah? I mean, you have two choices, yeah, in your life. Do something useful or waste the time. I think we have not yet realized that we are wasting our time. I mean, what is it that you can take with you, yeah, when you die? Reflect about it. Yeah, what?
Nothing.
Well, something. But certainly not the outside things, yeah? Your hair you can't take with you. The house, the family, the relations, all these things you can't take with you. The money, yeah? I mean, can even disappear while we are here. Just another crash, you know, and on the stock exchange, and then we are gone. Yeah? Or our governments take the money that we saved, yeah, because they need it. Or happened before. Why not now? Yeah? So these things we can't, yeah. But everything that we train the heart, this is the thing that we take with us. If we train the heart to be good, that's what we take with us. If we train the heart to be bad, that's what we take with us. And of course, it results of our actions. So, in this sense, everything, doing everything, you know, that is not useful, you know, I mean, it's a waste of time, or killing time. Yeah? But there's somebody in our ears and tells us, this is fun. This is necessary. I mean, who drives you on, yeah? Who tells you that you have to do this or that, yeah? I still have to accomplish this. I still have to accomplish that. I still have to go here. I still have to go there. Yeah. I still have to talk with this person. I still have to clear this thing. Yeah. And when we lie in bed, you know, just before our death, we still have to do so many things. There's no end. Yeah. I mean, every scientist knows, you know, if he solves one problem, you know, he has created 10 more problems. Yeah. So, I mean, there's no, it's not that it, you know, comes to an end, yeah? It always gets more and more. Yeah? In Buddhism, it's called proliferation, yeah? So, I mean, take the time that you spend here, yeah? And reflect. Reflect about what is useful and reflect about, you know, what is not necessary. In other words, set priorities in your life. Yeah? Well, you listen to something, you know, that makes you think. Yeah? Who are you, yeah, for instance? Have you figured it out yet? Who am I? Because if you look closely, you see only it's changing things. Yeah. There's no constancy. Yeah. There's only change that we see. But we still have this belief deep within us that we are eternal. And that's not wrong, yeah? I mean, the citta, yeah? That goes from Asia, yeah? To South America and to America and to Europe, you know? It goes, you know, from this planet to another planet. It's not the first planet we inhabited. We've been on other planets before. Yeah? But they've been destroyed, so I mean we had to, yeah, to look for another planet. Yeah? According to the Lord Buddha, we are the fourth civilization on this planet. We only think, you know, that human life existed about 10,000 years, 20,000 years ago. Is that true? That is this civilization. The civilization before, yeah, I mean, we have no clue. Yeah? And the civilization before that, we have no clue about it. But it was on Earth. And there will be one civilization coming after us. And that is the last on this planet. And then there will be another planet. It's not that, you know, this universe doesn't have enough planets, eh? Just like we hop from one land or from one continent to the other, you know, I mean, we hop from one planet to the other. If you don't set an end to this hopping, you know, to be born, being born in death, then I mean, you will stay on. Yeah? I mean, if you consider it to be fun, no problem with me. Yeah? If you think to be born, you know, and to educate this body, you know, for 15, 16 years, yeah? Yeah? And then watch it decay for 40 years, yeah? I mean, no problem. You can do that over and over and over again, yeah? There's no end to it, yeah? If you don't put a full stop there somewhere, you know? This is something that has, yeah, that you have to make yourself clear. But it's according to everybody's, you know, priorities. I mean, if you think, I mean, if you can bear the dukkha, you know, if you think, you know, that's fine, yeah, I mean, just go on, you know, there's no problem. The ball will roll on forever unless you stop it. Yeah? Unless we stop birth and death. And go back, you know, to where we come from. Yeah? Returning back home, yeah? It's a nice phrase, yeah? I think Jesus used it as well. Or it was used in the Bible. Yeah? The lost son, yeah? Returning back home. So through meditation, we come to a point where we can experience our true self. Yeah? And that is probably the most important thing in the beginning if we have no clue about what is going on. to experience that there is something that is the essence of us. And first of all, what we need to do is, you know, to stop thinking. Turn off the engine. Yeah. That's easy, you know. I mean, you have the path, yeah, how to stop thinking. Yeah? I mean, I know, yeah. I mean, the beauty about Buddhism is everything is easily said, you know, yet difficult to do. Easily said and easily understood. Yeah? If you turn off the key in the ignition key in your car, I mean, the engine stops. Yeah, no, all what we need to do is, yeah? And then we suddenly hear things that we didn't hear before. Yeah? And that's the same thing. If you stop thought, you know, we see things and hear things that we didn't hear before or didn't see before. I mean, we want to know the universe, we want to go out, we want to know these things, yeah? I mean, just look, you know, when you come, a day when you come home, you know, suddenly you want to know this, you want to know that, yeah? But you never want to know me, what is going on there. Yeah? Why do I want to know? Yeah? This we don't want, we don't care. We want to know what is the next galaxy, yeah? We want to know what is the next star system, you know? We want to know on which planet could there be life, yeah? I mean, we are looking for it. We probably found a few constellations, you know, in the galaxy where there is possible that there is life, yeah? That's what they're interested in. But they don't know. They don't want to know. Why do we exist? What is the purpose of life? Huh? I mean, isn't it a question that popped up a few times in our life? What am I doing here? Why am I here? You know, what is the purpose of life? Huh? And then we asked our parents or our friends and they said, oh, I'll just live on. Everybody does it, you know, so I mean, why ask this question, yeah? The last time I mentioned the four elements, that everything in this universe consists of four elements. Yeah? Our body, you know, I mean coarse elements, and that is earth, water, fire, air. You hear it? The wind? Yeah? You can call air movement, you can fire, you know, you can call fire heat, yeah? You can call water connectivity. And then you have everything in this universe, including our thoughts, including consciousness. Now when we go back to physics, we have two elements. I mean the atom and the electron. Now there's something, you know, that needs to be connected. Yeah? There must be a law. Yeah? That connects up these elements, you know, yeah? To make something out of them. And this law in Buddhism is called karma, yeah? Cause and effect. And it is the most important building block in Buddhism. I mean, we have the word, you know, in our daily language, yeah, to a certain degree, and we call it, don't do unto others what you don't want others to do unto you. Because, and now it's new, because whatever is done unto us, we have done unto others. And that is exactly what is karma. Karma is cause and effect. Whatever I think now will come back to me. Whatever I say now will come back to me. You could also call it the boomerang effect. You know, in Australia, no? The boomerang always comes back. If you use a boomerang to kill, yeah, to kill somebody, you know, it comes back to kill you. Yeah? And that is karma. If we would understand, yeah, the importance of karma, then we wouldn't do the things that we are doing. We wouldn't say, ah, it doesn't matter. We never would say that. Because everything matters, we know. If I pour, you know, if I pour oil in the flames, you know, it does matter. We can burn ourselves. Eh? So we wouldn't do that. Eh? But karma is something that is so difficult to understand, and it is so interwoven and intertwined, yeah, with a lot of things. Eh? Just think about, you know, in a simple way, you know, of a farmer, you know, who has a part or patch of land, yeah? I mean, he can grow certain things on it, yeah, because of the earth, because of the consistency of the earth, but he can't grow other things. Yeah? And he knows if he grows this, you know, I mean, if he let, you know, if he does it like this, you know, I mean, he can do it only, it used to be only 7 times, yeah? 7 years, yeah? And then he had to change the crop. Huh? This 7 is an interesting number, yeah? Because, I mean, most of the times, you know, we can, in this life we are doctor, next life we are doctor, we can do that 7 times, you know, and then it changes. Yeah? You cannot do it anymore. Yeah? Same, yeah? Being a woman 7 times, you know, and then it changes back to a man, yeah? Being a man 7 times changes back to a woman. Interesting. Huh? The women try to be men, you know, at least in Europe. Why? Yeah? The women slip. We don't like what we are. Yeah? We want all the things, you know, I mean, just like the saying, you know, for sheep, you know, the grass on the other side is greener. Huh? So we see what men are doing, you know, and we like to do the same thing, yeah? Men normally don't like to be women, yeah? But in some cases, you know, it is advantage, yeah? It has a certain advantage. So being satisfied with what we are, you know, is one way, you know, to accept karma. The important thing about karma is to accept it, yeah? Okay, I've did it, yeah? So I will receive it, yeah? As I said it before, you know, the soup that I made, you know, I had to eat it. Yeah? I mean, the moment we can, I mean, life becomes so much easier. We don't blame anybody else for this. Yeah? Now we blame our government, we blame our friends, you know, we blame, you know, the local government, or, the, you know, or sometimes, yeah. We blame other states, yeah? Or other ethnics, yeah? The Muslims, yeah? We are blamed now in Europe for all the disasters, yeah? It's nothing to do with it. We cannot blame ourselves, but think about it. How often do we blame ourselves? If we can't find if we can't find fault with others, yeah? But most of the time you can find fault with others. So karma is that. Yeah? I mean, it's an important aspect. Yeah? First of all, you know, it is very intertwined. Yeah, just like as I said, a very simple example is, you know, patch of land. Yeah, where a farmer grows certain things. Yeah, you can grow certain things, but you can't grow other things. Yeah, but if he changes the crops, he will be able to grow other things. Yeah? And that is exactly that with what happens to us. In this life, we can do certain amount of things. We can go in certain different directions, just like, you know, I can use a patch, you know, to plant different. But I cannot plant everything. Yeah? And so is it, you know, with our karma that we have in this world, yeah? In this life, yeah? Next life, it is mixed up again, yeah? So we get another patch of land, yeah? And then we can do other things. But we cannot do everything. Yeah? It is really important to understand karma. And it is really if we are really practitioners, if we call ourselves Buddhists, to accept karma. It's not the other person who does something unto us. It is just something that has come back. If we could accept that, I mean, we would lead a pretty happy life, yeah? I mean, we would be the 10% most happiest people in the world. We had no struggle, no fight with others. How many people have that? They have dukkha, they are discontent, they don't like this, they don't like that, yeah? I mean, if you are contented, you know, because we know it, we are the owner of our own karma. A Buddhist normally chants it every evening. Yeah? We are the heir to our karma, we are the owner of the karma, we are we are the ones who did this karma. I mean, whatever I did, you know, I have to get, yeah, I have to say yes, sorry, yeah. I mean, we do mistakes, yeah. Do you think we could evolve if we don't make mistakes? No way. We learn through our mistakes. Yeah? And that is a positive aspect. If somebody doesn't learn anything, doesn't admit that he made a mistake, he cannot learn from it. So that is a stupid person. It's not a good person or intelligent person who doesn't do mistakes. But it's a stupid person who doesn't learn from his mistakes, and it is an intelligent person who learns from its mistakes. So making mistakes, that's not a problem. But learning from the mistakes, that is the thing that makes us clever, that makes us smart, yeah? And opens us ways that we haven't seen before. If you see a door, you know, that is difficult to open, you know, but you want to know what is behind it, you know, the person tries it a little, forget it, yeah, it doesn't matter really. The other person tries a little bit harder, you know, opens the door, and there's a whole new hallway, yeah. But it can also be, you know, a door that leads, you know, to a dark black chamber, you know. I mean, okay, then we see it, open it, okay, close it again. Yeah? I mean, think about, you know, I mean, think about the creativity of the human beings, yeah? I mean, most of the things, you know, that we advance to, yeah, if it is advancement at all, you know, is done by mistake, yeah? Discovered by mistake, you know, somebody was looking for something else and discovered this, yeah? So we learn. So karma is nothing else, you know? What we do, you know, how we can change it is trial and error. You know? We try this. So, when we sit down in meditation, we try Buddha. Yeah? Then the thoughts coming up, then we try it again, you know, Buddha. You know? Until it, you know, one time it sticks. Yeah? And then we see, that's a new open door. Yeah? That's a new era, that's a new world or new realm that we can experience. Yeah? But if we don't open this door, we can't experience it. And the same thing with investigation. It opens us a completely new path. It opens us a completely new point of view. I mean, if you're always, you know, in downtown area, I mean, yeah, all what we see is, you know, I mean, to our height. Yeah? If you climb up, you know, a tower, yeah, that has a look over the whole city and even more, we understand more what things are going on. People who never come out of their part of the city, I mean, they don't know what is really going on. I mean, if they take a step back or 10 steps back or 100 steps back, you know, and have a view, then they probably would understand, you know, how the traffic works and things like this. Yeah? And that's what we do with the investigation. We take a few steps back. Yeah? The first thing, how we do to take a step back is, yeah, say, yeah, not I'm feeling, there is a feeling. That's a step back, yeah? Then I can watch the feeling. Oh, is it pleasant, unpleasant, or neutral? Yeah, I mean, we know it instantly, yeah? And then we can see it arising and ceasing. we can understand, yeah? I mean, karma is cause and effect. So if you want to understand why these things come in this kind of combination, yeah, or the right, then we have to observe them very closely. It's not as easy, you know, as sitting under an apple tree, you know, and watching the apple fall down and then getting the Newton law, yeah? But it is similar. Yeah? So we observe. Yeah? Just for instance, you know, I explained to you before, you know, what emotion, how emotion arises, yeah? I mean, if you sit there and observe, yeah? Then we see a thought or feeling or sense contact coming in, yeah? Sense contact, I mean, you can call it bodily part, yeah? Sense contact coming in, then a feeling arises, the thought, memory, you know, and within no time, you know, it's an emotion. Yeah? And then you see you can also stop it at any time. You can watch it, you know, like a movie and see, yeah, okay, so. As long as you keep it there to observe it, you know, I mean, it doesn't affect you. The moment you think, I'm angry, you know, then it's gone. Yeah? Then you take on something that doesn't belong to you. So to understand karma is really important. Yeah? It's to understand how things work together. Just like I said with the watch, you know, open it up and see how the wheels turn into each other. Yeah? Why? You know, if I stop this wheel, I mean, everything stops. Yeah? So, for instance, if you stop one of the wheels, you know, if you get one pointed, you know, everything stops. If you slow down, you know, one of the wheels, everything slows down. That is, for instance, upacara samadhi. When we slow down thoughts, you know, a lot of things will not appear. Like worries, fear, loneliness, yeah? Future, past, they will not appear. That's how we slowly, through investigation, through always observing, investigation is mostly done by observing. Through observing we will understand. The problem is we not only have to observe one time, we have to observe 10 times, 100 times, 1,000 times, 10,000, 1,000,000 times, until it clicks, yeah? Remember, you know, when you were studying something, you know, I mean, you not only had to read the paragraph one time, you know, you sometimes had to read it 10 times before you understood what was said. And it only, the problem was, yeah, the concentration. We didn't like the subject, so that's why we had to read it so often, yeah? Because our thoughts were always somewhere else. Yeah? If we would have known that, you know, 20 or 30 years ago, you know, I mean, we just would have concentrated, get over with it, yeah? And then do the things that we wanted to do. Yeah? But no, you know, I mean, by not liking something, we don't, you know, we don't concentrate it. Concentrate on it. And that's why we have to do it so often. There was a group at the time of the Lord Buddha, there was a group, you know, who had the sati, you know, I mean, 99% of it, yeah, all the time, yeah? 24 hours a day. I mean, think about that, that's amazing already. Yeah? So within 7 days they could investigate everything, yeah, and they were finished. Yeah? And then the Lord Buddha said, you know, I mean, you can reach enlightenment within 7 days, 7 months, 7 years, 7 lifetimes, yeah? It depends all on the sati, on the strength of awareness. Yeah? Just get awareness for 24 hours a day for 7 days and you get enlightened. Yeah? Well, it's very simple. But can we do it? No. None of us. Yeah? I mean, especially the younger generation, you know, I mean, it's so distracted. Yeah. I mean, all these things. Yeah. I mean, just think about, you know, your phone, you know, in the pocket. Yeah. You constantly, you know, pulls your attention to somewhere else. Yeah? The news, you know, whatever. Yeah? The internet, yeah? I mean, people get completely lost. Yeah. So, I mean, it's not like in these old times, you know. I mean, I remember, probably you might remember, you know, when when there was nothing to do. I mean, there was no telly, there was no there was no phone, except for the phone in the house, you know, the moment you went out, you know, I mean, there was nothing, yeah? Nothing going on, yeah? We called it boring Sunday afternoon, yeah? Nothing was open as well, yeah? So what to do, you know, go in the woods and play, you know, with your friends, yeah? Needing creativity, yeah? I mean, we had to make up these games, you know, and we had to follow the rules of our games that we made up, yeah? And now they're just, you know, I mean, they just download these games, you know, and follow the rules of somebody else, yeah? How many people, you know, I mean, you see in the trains and airplanes playing these stupid games, yeah? So understanding cause and effect, understanding karma. The problem with our karma in this life is that this is born of actions that we did in the past. 95% of the actions that we did in the past is the cause of what we experience now. Just like 95%, you know, of the actions that we do in this life, we experience in the next life. And that is can be compared, you know, to a farmer, you know, that sows potatoes or wheat, yeah? Now, that good meal, you know, I mean, they're quite nutritious, yeah? But he has to wait 6 months, yeah? I mean, if he grows salad, you know, I mean, within 4 weeks, you know, it's done. Yeah? So some of the karma, you know, it is just like salad, you know, I mean, it grows fast, yeah? But it's not of a lot of nutrition, yeah? So some of the karma comes back in this life, but most of the karma that we do now comes back in the next life. So all the karma that we experience in this life, you know, I mean, is born of the karma that we did in previous lives. And not only one life, you know, it's a mixture. For instance, if you think about an apple tree, you put a seed in and you have to wait 7 years, yeah, for the first fruit to grow. But then it comes every year, every year, every year. So some of the karma, it has to wait for 7 lives, you know. And then from then on, it brings fruit every life, every life, every life. Yeah? Until it is exhausted. So it's very difficult if we don't take a step back, you know, and look at our different lives, you know, to understand actually what is going on. Why are we in the difficulties we are? Yeah? Why do we experience the problems that we have? Yeah? But if you take a stance, you know, and say, okay, so whatever is coming, you know, is what I've done, you know, understand it, accept it, you know, and get rid of it. Then we can get rid of the karma. The moment we oppose one of the karmas that we created, I mean, we make it stronger. And so strong, and next life even stronger, yeah? I mean, a person who doesn't want to be oppressed, you know? Nobody wants to be oppressed, yeah? But everybody likes to oppress others. A person doesn't, you know, doesn't accept to be oppressed and fights against it, you know, kills us, you know, oppresses, yeah? I mean, in the next life he's put in a situation where he can't. And that is much worse, yeah? He's put in a situation where he's locked in, yeah? And it always becomes worse and worse until, you know, you stand with the back to the wall, you know, and can't help them receive the dukkha. I mean, we don't want to be that stupid, yeah? We want to be able to deal with it, you know, in a way, you know, that is beneficial to us. Yeah? So we want to say, okay, whatever happens to me is born of my own karma, so I accept it, you know, and let it go. If my wife leaves me or partner leaves me, okay, let it go. If I get sick, if I get really ill, accept it. But also there, I mean, just like in a partnership, you try, you know, you try to mend it. If it doesn't work out, you know, let it go. Same, you go to one or two or three doctors, you know, if they can help you, it's fine. If they can't help you, it's also fine. And accept it, not run to 1,000 doctors. If you can be cured, it will be cured. That is also karma. Sometimes we get certain illnesses. You know, some people get, you know, cancer, yeah? For some people it can be cured, others it can't be cured. It's all karma. But it is not like the understanding of the Indians, of the people in India. They think, you know, it is a fixed rule. No. Every moment, just like we go outside, you know, I mean, we walk along a street, and then there's a crossing coming. At every moment in our life, we can choose. We can choose to go right. This might lead to the desert. We can choose to go left. This might lead to a forest. We can choose to go straight on. This might lead to a city. But even then, you know, there will be crossings there. When we approach the city, we see it's too dense, it's polluted, then we can go right or left. It's not that it's completely determined. But the strength of our karmas will draw us automatically in a certain direction. Like you've seen in your life. In one type of karma that draws you actually here. See, it's also there, You didn't think about it 5 years ago, It comes up, Just like, when we walk along a road, a crossing comes up, And then we can decide. So we can decide every moment, to walk, In which way we want to walk, And the more we understand about ourselves, the more we understand our aspirations, our wishes, our desires, the more we can go into that direction. But there will be other karma, that is holding back onto us. Just typical karma, some people have a lot of possessions, they don't want to leave it behind. Other people have a family, Other people have children, That can hold us back, These things can hold us back. So that is one type of karma, Although we want to go this path, we are held back by these things, by other karma. So at every moment, we have always choices. This is something you have to understand. But for the normal people that just go the strongest path, they just put their air mattress into the river and flow down the river of their strongest karma. For a person who is wise, sees there's a nice little groove, let's go in there. No, they just close their eyes and flow down. The river of the strongest karma is what leads people in their life, and that holds true for at least 70 or 80% of the population. They just lie down blinded, blindfolded, because they don't want to get sunburned, so. Interesting about a good astrologer, He said the same thing, I can see what happens to people who go down the road. But if a person develops him spiritually, that means he chooses different options on his path. The more he goes in different directions, I cannot tell anything about what is going to happen to him. The stars, if you believe it or not, The time you're born are very important. It tells, a person who knows about karma tells very much about that person. When he was born, what was his ascendant, descendant, and so on. I don't know it. But I heard it from people. But you always have the option. That's what I want to say with that. If you blindfold yourself, go into the air mattress, then Yeah, I mean, then you're caught, you know, you just flow the river. And not only that, when you go the strongest along the path of your strongest karma, you will make that karma stronger. And then in the next life it is more difficult. Yeah? This kind of karma is just like driving your car. Yeah, I mean, maybe you have a four-wheel car, you know, you drive it in the mud. The deeper you drive it in the mud, the more difficult it is to draw out. Yeah? Or to pull out. Yeah? That is the strongest karma. I mean, if you go this life and that life, you know, the strongest kind of karma, you know, I mean, then we will end up sometimes, you know, we get stuck, you know. And then to pull it out, it is more difficult. Yeah? If you see it is mud, you know, I mean, we get out, you know, and then pulling out, it is very easy. Yeah? So not necessarily following the strongest karma is a wise choice, yeah? Assessing, you know, what do we want from this life? I mean, just like I said in the beginning, setting the priorities. What do I want? Yeah? When I die, and it can happen any moment, yeah? When I die, what do I want to take with me? I mean, every one of us, you know, I probably assume right, you know, wants happiness and contentment. Yeah? So if I go a path, you know, that leads to contentment, yeah, then I will take that contentment with me. Because the contentment is born in a heart, yeah. I mean, I don't mean the physical heart, because the physical heart dies, yeah. It's born in the citta. Yeah? And when we look for the karma is something that attaches to the citta and takes it with you. Yeah? So from this birth to that birth to that birth. Yeah? Just like a river, yeah. I know it only from the Rhine. It starts in Switzerland, you know, I go through Germany, then through Belgium, Holland and Belgium, yeah. The Rhine, the river is always the same, yeah. But just because it is there, you know, we call it this, you know, if it is there, we call it that, you know, we call it in this country, we call it that. Yeah? So that karma that attaches, yeah, or holds the citta, yeah, is the thing that goes from one life to the next. It's not, yeah. You can also call it personality, yeah, or you can, but it is much better to call it karma, yeah. So there is actually no rebirth. It's just a transition to another country or a transition into another realm of existence, yeah? Depending on where the karma flows, yeah? Yeah. But like, you know, with every kind of river, I mean, we can change its bed, yeah? We can change its direction. And that's what we are actually doing when we are Buddhists. Yeah? We don't want, you know, our river, you know, to flow through desert, you know, where it's useless, you know, we want to flow it back to where it came from, actually to the ocean. Yeah? And that's why we have to, yeah, investigate, really, and be aware of the choices that we make in our life. Yeah? And don't underestimate, you know, I mean, sometimes it might be easier. Yeah? If you decide, you know, to go on the path of practice, yeah, be it, you know, 50%, 25%, you know, or 100%, don't underestimate the karma that is in the background. Yeah? It always tries to pull you away from it. I mean, I've seen so many people in my 20 years that I'm here. I've seen people. I mean, they've stayed here for 3 months, you know, and then just wanted to go back home, you know, and come back, you know, to, yeah? Never ever saw them again, yeah? There's something, suddenly, you know, something pops up, you know, and you think, ah, yes, this is important, yeah? And then you forget everything. Yeah? Don't underestimate it, you know, I mean, if you choose the path, you know, if you choose the path of deliverance, yeah, be careful that you don't forget meditation and don't forget reflection. What am I doing? Why am I doing this? What kind of results does it have? Yeah. Because the kilesas are the masters of deception. Yeah. They deceive us and they make us forget the most important things, and they make the most unimportant things the most important ones. They flip it upside down. Yeah? Oh, I can meditate tomorrow, but now I need to do this. The most important thing, that's why I said, you know, get your priorities straight, yeah? I mean, you can do whatever you want, you know, if you meditate in the morning, in the evening, do your reflection, and then the rest of the time you still have, I mean, 22 hours of a day, you know, I mean, do whatever you like to. But don't forget this, yeah? Put everything around it, yeah? Not try to fit it in. Try to fit it in never works out. Yeah? And you've seen it, you know, I mean, just going back to England, I mean, how many unimportant things suddenly come up. Yeah, that's a good idea, that's a good idea, that's a good idea. Yeah? And suddenly you were completely lost in these outside things, yeah? And didn't remember, you know, the basic thing. Yeah, tomorrow.
It's difficult.
Yeah, I mean, of course it is difficult. I mean, it will be difficult in our practice. Yeah? For some people, you know, I mean, because I mean, the practice in so many previous lives, you know, it will be easy. Yeah, once they get the path into it, it will become very easy for them. For other people, you know, there will be some heavy karma. Yeah? And it will always try to pull them up.
Just
about
the
yeah. Yeah. Always something comes up. And that's what we have to be aware of. Yeah? That's why it is really important for us, you know, to set priorities. Yeah? And then everything else, yeah? I mean, it really does matter. Yeah? As long as we do one thing, yeah? This one thing comes before everything else. Yeah? I've done it, that's why I know it. I mean, when I had to go to a meeting and get an airplane, instead of getting up at 6 o'clock, I got up at 4 o'clock. Just to be able to do my meditation before I do anything. And yeah, I mean, you have to have some perseverance and you have to put in some effort, you know, to do this. If it is important. Yeah? So while you're here, try to get some results, at least calmness. Yeah? Where you see, I mean, actually there's nothing, there's no problem in this world. Yeah? The moment the heart is contented, it's contented. Yeah? We don't need to buy this or we don't need to do this to get contented. Yeah? This contentment is only, I mean, it's so short-lasting. Yeah? I mean, if we have a wish that we can fulfill, how long does our contentment last? 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and then we wish something out. Oh yes, that's nice, but yeah, we would like to have this now, yeah, because we have this, now we need this, yeah. Yeah? But if our desire is not fulfilled, that's dukkha. Yeah? That's a lot of dukkha. So contentment arises not in what, if our wishes are fulfilled or not. Yeah? Contentment arises in our heart. Yeah? That is the important message that the Lord Buddha gave us. But it's also that dukkha arises in our heart. So we don't need anybody else, you know, to tell us, you know, what is going on in our heart. We ourselves, we just need to look in our heart to see what is going on. We see some aggression coming up, we see some greed coming up, we see some discontent coming up, we see some restlessness coming up, boredom coming up. Yeah? I mean, the more we look, I mean, we don't want to believe it in the beginning, how much is there. Yeah? It's not outside, it is all inside there. Yeah? And that's why we need to clean out the place. So understand karma, I mean, accept it, you know, I mean, sometimes, I mean, really, you have to bite your teeth, yeah? It's fine, yeah? You bite your teeth and after 5 minutes or 5 hours or 5 days, it's gone. But don't do anything against it. Don't try to oppose it. If there's a way to mend it, okay, try to mend it. If it doesn't work out, okay, accept it. It's just like, you know, you go close to a factory, chemical factory, you know, and where they just blow out, you know, really bad smoke. Yeah? You breathe it in, you know what it is, and then you go on. It's important also, you know, to, once we can accept it, we can look at it. Yeah? What is it? It's a smell, okay, there's a smell. There's a good smell, there are bad smells, there are neutral smells. And the more you look, you know, you will see. The only thing that exists are good smells, bad smells, neutral smells. Good feelings, bad feelings, neutral feelings. And everything else is made up. So the first thing is to accept, and the next thing is to look. I mean, where is it coming from? Ask yourself what came before. I mean, the clearer you see, I mean, the more you know actually where it's coming from. You can even see the reason from previous lives if you're clear enough. Where you exactly did that on that person. Or on another person. It's not ever, it's not the same person that does it to you. But we are not clear. We are agitated by something is happening to us. Yeah? Or somebody is doing something onto us, that's why we are not clear. We can't see clearly. And the moment we accept it, we could see clearly, and then we start to investigate. See, what is coming for? Before what is coming up. And before, and before, and before. Yeah? Just like with the avalanche, you know, roll it back until you find the stone that is within it. Yeah? Or break it apart to find the stone that is within it. What came before? What?
It's time to throw the stones and it's time to pick up the stones.
Yeah, I mean, you don't want to throw the stones if you don't like to get hurt.
I think it was from the Bible.
Well?
It's time to throw the stones and it's time to pick up the stones. Mm. Sorry.
So there's just towards the end, the Lord Buddha gave, you know, just to understand, you know, what kind of karma we are in. You know, the Lord Buddha gave a few examples about karma. You know. Becoming a woman is karma, becoming a man is karma. You know. Having a short life is karma, having a long life is karma. So the Lord Buddha said, you know, those who don't kill or harm other beings will have a long life. Those who kill and harm other beings will have a short life. Those who are generous will become rich. Those who serve others will become beautiful. Isn't it something that we, you know, we do admire beauty in others? Why do we admire it? Because there's something behind that. Yeah? Also we admire richness because there's something, you know, something completely different behind it. Generosity, people who are generous, people who give. Yeah? But, I mean, most of the time, you know, because it happened in our last life, we forget if we become rich and then we become greedy and stingy and then we fall off. Because then in the next life we will get poor again. So things are changing also, yeah? Somebody who is beautiful, I mean most of the times in this world, you know, in our times, you know, they use their beauty to sell it. So the thing that makes us actually beautiful or handsome, serving other people without thinking about themselves, yeah, is lost. So the next life they will become ugly again.
Or normal.
Yeah. It all changes. Huh? If we are rich and continue on the way, we become richer and richer. And hopefully not falling off sometimes. If we continue on the path, you know, when we are beautiful to serve others, you know, we become more and more beautiful. Somebody who lies, you know, stinks out of his mouth. We know a few people, yeah. It's a protection for others. Yeah? Some people who do bad karma is a protection for others. Yeah? We don't like to talk with somebody who really smells bad, has a bad breath, do we? It's a natural thing, you know, and it's karmic. Yeah? Just a few of these examples. Yeah? There can be beautiful people who have a bad breath, you know. So, I mean, it's a mixture of this karma. Yeah? I mean, they went, you know, they sometimes saw a very beautiful big goldfish, you know, and they brought it to the Buddha because, I mean, the moment the goldfish opened its mouth, I mean, it was a devastating smell. So they asked him what it is. Yeah? I mean, the beauty was being able to serve others, you know, and the bad breath has come from constantly lying. Yeah? So next life, you know, we recognize all our politicians, you know, by don't want to even get close to them. Most of the politicians, we don't even want to get close to them because they already have a bad breath. Yeah? So just a few things about this karma. Yeah? And it is karma, it is not, you know, it's not the person, you know, it's not this body, you know, that gets reincarnated. It's not the soul that gets reincarnated. It's just a transition. Yeah? The karma is a flow, you know, I mean, but it's not only one flow. It's a lot of possibilities we have each moment. Yeah? Don't forget that, yeah. It's not, oh, it's my karma, you know, a lot of ties, you know. Say, yeah, oh, it's my karma, you know, I have to go this way, I can't ordain, yeah? They say it differently, I say, I don't have enough parami, yeah? I don't have enough bun or merits, you know, to go this path. No, it's just a, yeah, excuse, yeah? They don't want to. No? We can do, like I said last time, if we want to do something, we can do it. Yeah? Doesn't mean that it will be easy. There might be a lot of hindrances. We don't know, yeah? If we choose another path, what kind of hindrances come, yeah? Because if we choose another path, everybody knows, you know, if he goes through a forest, he will meet different dangers than when he goes through the meadows, yeah? In the meadows, there might be more snakes, you know, or other things, yeah, slimy things. In the forest, there might be some big animals, yeah? So no matter what path we choose, you know, we will experience also different karma. Yeah? But it's all karma that we have created. I mean, we have lived billions of lives, yeah? I mean, the karma that we have, yeah, is like, you can call it a Tibetan mountain, yeah? And all what you took in this life, you know, is a backpack, yeah? Of this kind of karma in this life. So next, you know, when you die, you know, the next time it is, you know, muddled up again, and then you get a different backpack. Or you get the same backpack or a similar backpack. It depends on how you live your life. How you live your life, yeah. And from now on, you know, to the end of your life, I mean, you set the priority of practice, yeah, and meditation, number one, you know, I mean, then it is very, very possible, very likely that in the next life you just continue on this way. Yeah? But if you switch in this lifetime, 1 month, you know, I'll do practice, you know, 9 months I don't do practice, you know, I mean, then it is very unclear what is going to happen. Yeah? So get your priority state, yeah? I just wanted to explain it because it is the law. Karma is the law that governs this universe, yeah? Nothing outside of karma, you know, happens. Yeah? Okay? And for some people it might be more difficult, and for some people it might be easier.
Is there a karma that is so
being. No. Everything, you have so many different kinds of karma at every moment. Yeah? There is not a karma, you know, that is
unsurmountable.
Yeah. There's not one karma that cannot be overcome. But there's some heavy karma that you think you cannot overcome. That you think you have to follow.
So if I say it's a heavy karma, how
Yeah, do you... I mean heavy karma is something that pulls you, yeah? It is just like, you know, just like any kind of child, you know, who pulls you not to leave her. Yeah? And, you know, and it will tell me, if you leave me, you know, you are a bad mother, you know. Yeah. So, I mean, this kind of karma can happen. Yeah? I mean, the Lord Buddha left his 1 year old and his wife, yeah.
Does that need panya? You need wisdom to be able to decide on such heavy karma.
Yeah, of course you need wisdom, you know, but most of the people don't have enough wisdom. Yeah? So what you need is, you know, somebody who can differentiate, somebody who has this wisdom. That's why on the path, most of the time, we do need a spiritual friend. We do need a teacher. I mean, think about what did the Lord Buddha say about a spiritual friend. And Ananda asked him, a spiritual friend, and mostly it is, you know, recognized as a teacher, is half of the spiritual life. And then the Lord Buddha answered, no, my friend, don't say that. A spiritual friend, a Kalayanamitta, is the whole spiritual life. If I didn't have my teacher here, I mean, I wouldn't be able to progress. I mean, I don't have the panya. Yeah? Or I didn't have the panya. Didn't have the wisdom. Yeah? Sometimes I would just go wrong, you know, because I thought it was right. Yeah? Until somebody stepped on my toes and said, yeah, that's wrong. Yeah? We cannot be... Although we have all the wisdom within our heart, we don't have the access yet. So somebody needs sometimes to clear the path for us, you know, and show us what is right and what is wrong. Yeah? And he, a good teacher has various ways of showing us. Yeah? Hmm? Sometimes he just needs some gestures, and sometimes he needs, you know, to really scold us really heavily. Yeah?
Is that what a reflection? How do you decide? How does the transition from the meditation and taking your, you know, getting rid of the thoughts? How do you transition from that to reflection and know the difference?
I mean, it is for meditation, doing calm. You know, I mean, so all the time you go to the Buddha, and then you say, okay, after 1 hour, okay, I stop. Now I want to know what happened. This morning, what did I think this morning when I woke up, yeah? What did I do then? How did I feel? What did I think, yeah? And in the beginning, just call steps, yeah? Just to see, objectively to see without touching.
So it's like a next...
Yeah, it's a separate entity. Reflection is a separate entity. I mean, I was... 2 days ago, I mean, I talked about investigation of the body. That's a separate entity. So we have to actually cut down. We shouldn't meddle that up. Yeah? When we want to get calm, we should get calm. When we want to investigate, we should investigate. And not always constantly switching around. Yeah.
Oh. Is that hard? Imagine that's one of the hard things to do. You don't...
Yes. Because then something, you know, during meditation, once the mind gets calm, something interesting comes up and we want to investigate that. Yeah. I mean, that's not the way. Hmm. Then we never get calm. So don't meddle this up, yeah? If now you say, I mean, whatever time it is, 45 minutes, 1 hour, 2 hours, just samadhi, yeah? The only exception for samadhi, when we sit, is investigating pain that comes up. That is allowed. So we go to the pain and ask, what is pain?
You're talking about when you meditate?
Yeah. when you do sitting meditation, when you do samadhi, yeah?
Okay.
Yeah. When you do investigation, I mean, there are no pain, interesting, no pain is coming up, yeah? You can sit for 2 hours, do investigation, and no pain comes. Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Strange, yeah? But if you sit, you know, for 2 hours and do puttu, 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 you know, oh, our whole body is on fire, yeah? Why? Yeah? And that's why we need to investigate pain. What is pain? Yeah? Where is it actually? Yeah? When you sit in, you know, in the cinema or, you know, from Finland it's probably also 8 hours to fly here to Thailand, there's no pain. Yeah? When you sit here just for an hour, oh, it all burns, you know. I'm on fire. Yeah? When you think about something, you know, when you do or read something, you know, there's no fire. Yeah? So what is pain? Yeah? That is one and the foremost investigation that we normally do. Yeah? Where is the pain first? What is pain? Does it change? Does it not change? Yeah? Is it point-wise? Is it area-wise? Yeah? And we concentrate on the pain just like we concentrate on the Buddha, yeah? Or on the breath. Yeah? Just go with our concentration there, yeah? And then look at it. Yeah? And then what happens to most of the people, yeah? If you're really interested in what is pain, it will disappear instantly. It's a spook, yeah? It's something, spook. You know what a spook is? Yeah. Yeah, it's something ghostly, you know, it doesn't really exist, but it seems so real, yeah? The moment we concentrate on, yeah? It doesn't exist anymore. What then can happen, you know, if you go on, you know, what can happen, you know, you investigate it, you know, you can investigate it very clearly, your mind doesn't wander off, yeah? And then you're just close to the truth, you know, and then it jumps somewhere else. Before it was this knee, then it's this knee, yeah? Then you go there, and you investigate, then it's suddenly the back, and then it's the head, then it's the neck, then it's the shoulders, yeah? And then you follow it up until it shows you where it actually comes from. And once you understand where it's coming from, then you don't need to bother with pain anymore. It's not that the pain is then pleasant. No, it doesn't become pleasant anyway, but you are not bothered by it. So the first thing when we do long meditation is to investigate pain. What is pain? Where is it? Is it in the skin? I have skin since I am born, you know, so I should be constantly in pain, yeah? Is it in the bones? Yeah, I have bones since I was born, yeah? Is it in the tendons? Yeah? Is it in the flesh? Yeah? Locate it, try to locate it really, yeah? Where it is, yeah? And don't let your medical knowledge come through, yeah? Oh yeah, I sit too long, yeah? Then say, I sit in the airplane, I sit 11 hours and there's no pain. Why is it now, yeah? I mean, be smart, yeah? The answers that are coming are the answers of the Kilesas who want to distract you. You can't believe them. Yeah? So you have to undermine them. Yeah? So if they say, I sit too long, you know, I mean, that's why I have pain, yeah? I sit in the airplane 11 hours, you know, I don't have pain. So why now, yeah? It cannot be that, yeah? So look, yeah? What is pain? Where is pain, yeah? How does it feel? The first thing is you investigate the change in nature. It's not constant. Sometimes, you know, it grows, you know, then it falls up, you know, then it grows again, you know, and yeah. It is much more interesting and people can stay longer on it, you know, than on their Buddha, yeah. I mean, so for some of the practitioners, when pain comes, they feel relief because before it was boring, now it becomes interesting. Yeah, you can stay much longer, yeah? Because it is, you know, once you question in an interesting way, something is becoming interesting. Yeah? Doesn't matter, you know, I mean, the pain is not so strong. Yeah?
Huh?
If you move one time, I mean, you can count, yeah. 5 minutes later, you get up.
So let's say in an hour, can you move once?
No.
Okay.
I mean, just just find out for yourself. The moment you move, you want to move again and move again. Then look at the watch, you know, when you want to move, then move, you know, and see how much later you get up. And I can guarantee it cannot be longer than 5 or 15 minutes. If you don't move, you can sit much longer. Yeah, but investigate pain. Be happy. Ah, there's pain. Now I have a really steady object. I mean, we are afraid of pain, that's why we run away. We run to the doctor because of pain, yeah? We are afraid of pain, that's why we take pills, yeah? How much money does it cost, you know? I mean, to constantly run to the doctor because we are afraid of pain. Give us some painkillers, yeah? Yeah, isn't it? So if we investigate pain, yeah, and can live with pain, you know, I mean, then it doesn't matter. Yeah? I sometimes have splitting headaches, you know, it doesn't really matter, you know. I still can give a good talk. Yeah? Splitting headaches are just splitting headaches. Yeah? I mean, it's not comfortable, but it's just, you know, it's just something. Yeah? Be afraid, that's it. Yeah? And that's why they can move us. To avoid pain, they tell us, you know, I mean, in order to avoid pain, you do this and do that. Yeah? And we do it, and still there is pain. Yeah? In the end, there will be dukkha. Yeah? That's how they can direct us. Yeah? Yeah. If you don't go this way, you know, I give you the leash, yeah? And if you really don't want to go, you know, throw it hard on me. In the end, you know, we will give in because we don't want to feel the leash, yeah? But that is the way, you know, somebody... Yeah, it's like any suppressing army is doing. Any bank robber is doing, you know, holds a pistol, you know, I mean, if you don't move, I kill you. Yeah? What do? We move. We do bad things, you know, if somebody, you know, does that, yeah? Isn't it? That's how the world moves, yeah? If you don't do this, you will lose your money, okay? You will cheat, yeah? For somebody else, yeah? Or do bad things. Because we are afraid, yeah? We are afraid of pain, yeah? I mean, not only physical pain, we are also afraid of mental pain. Yeah? And that's how the kilesas, yeah, can move us, can direct us. Just like an army that occupies another country can tell the people what to do because they're afraid to die. I mean, this experience we have everywhere. They just come with their, you know, with their weapon, you know, and say, I mean, if you don't go this way, you know, I mean, I shoot you. And then we go. Everybody does that. Yeah? So it seems to be normal. Yeah? But now we should see, just like these people, yeah, I mean, if they are oppressed too much, yeah, then they will stand up and fight. Yeah? But in their fight, I mean, now let's look at a physical fight. Get up, stand up for your rights, and I mean, we know that. If they get up for their fights, some of them lose their lives, some of them lose their arms, some of them lose their legs, yeah? They are not afraid to do that. If we sit in meditation and try to get our freedom, we can't even bear that little pain. We don't lose anything. We don't ruin our body, you know, I mean, there's just a little pain and we give up already, yeah? So we are not really freedom fighters, yeah? We don't want freedom, you know, I mean, we only want to have freedom, you know, when it is comfortable. If you're afraid of hell, you have to swim through the fires of hell. If you're afraid of pain, you have to know, you have to understand what is pain. That's what I mean with swim through the fires of hell means understand what is hell. Yeah? understand what is pain, you know, then you cannot be moved. Yeah. If you understand something, yeah, everybody knows it. If you understand something, you know, he's not moved by it. Yeah. I mean, think about, you know, when you were in the first semester and some prof told you some fantastic things and you were completely moved or excited about that. Yeah. And once you went through 8 semesters, you understood it and you think, yeah, that wasn't really anything what you said. Yeah. Once we understand something, we are not moved by it anymore. That's the whole thing. You can call the kilesas, you know, the magicians, yeah? I mean, we know, you know, when we go in a magic show, I mean, we are completely pulled in, yeah? But if you go behind the stage and know how he does it, you know, we are not pulled in by it anymore. And that's exactly what we do in our practice. We go behind the stage, see how he does that trick, and pain is one trick, yeah? See how he does that trick, and then we are not pulled in. Okay?